The Out of Bounds Show podcast is powered by the DeWalt Tools at Ace Bolt and Screw. Visit acebolt.net for a location near you.
RKS Pickens Jackson.
All systems go.
Live from the Whiskey 61 Lounge inside the Bank Plus Studio.
This is now in order.
Live in the studio.
It's the Out of Bounds Show with Bo Bounds.
Streaming live worldwide on the Out of Bounds radio app.
And on your radio at ESPN
105.9. All set? Let's go.
The Zone.
Good morning, good morning. We're going to call a little audible here on a Wednesday. The Out of Bounds Show, 105.9 The Zone, ESPN. ESPN. I'm your host, Bo Bounds. You're listening to The Zone. The Zone, 105.9. Streaming live on the Out of Bounds radio app. I want to say good morning to you. Hope you're doing well. Thanks for making us your sports and entertainment show of choice in the great state of Mississippi, and thanks for streaming the show out of state. I hear from you all the time when you take your walk in the morning or whatever you're doing, a little workout. Hey, I've got you on the Out of Bounds radio app or the zone1059.com. That's a good thing. I've got Blake Mania with me. Hope you're doing well. We've got some fun topics today. Lane Kiffin, the man, the myth, and the legend, the Lane Train, was at the podium yesterday. SEC Media Days, baby. He's dropped 30 pounds. Looking rather dapper, the Lane Train, in his suit in Hoover/Birmingham, Alabama.
Just trying to find some recruits.
You darn right he is. Matt Corral looked great. And I don't think that Matt Corral has trouble getting a date. Dude looked super sharp in his suit, and it was Ole Miss Day yesterday in Hoover, Alabama. And I thought Parrish Alford did a really good job, by the way. We were busy yesterday, roaming pretty good. I didn't really get to stop, but for, you know, 15, 20-minute chunks here and there. But thought Parrish Alford did a good job covering the Ole Miss Rebels media days. And Lane, we'll talk about it. Blake's got some stuff from the Lane Train. Will drop during the SEC Insider hit at 7:30. He was asked about, obviously, Matt Corral, Jerrion Ealy, his defense, losing weight, and, you know, all sorts of things. So Corral did a cool hit, well, several, on multiple platforms throughout the day, too. He's the best quarterback returning in the SEC. It's not close. And, you know, we expect him to have a phenomenal year and get drafted in the NFL. Where that is, who knows? I will say Mike Dettillier said he's a second, early second-round pick. And I said, well, what does he have to do to – I thought Mike made a great point when I asked this question. And I said, well, what does he have to do to get into the, you know, top 15 or 20? He said, Bo, that's not that big a jump. And I thought about it, and that's not a big jump for a quarterback. Maybe for a different player. For a quarterback, that's not a big jump. With the demand, supply, demand, the fact that you have to have one to win on Sunday, Monday night, Thursday night, that's not a big jump. And I've got him already, you know. I mean, if you made me bet today, Bo, you got to bet $1,000. Pearl River Resort, Golden Moon Casino. You have to bet a grand. You got to go one way or another. Well, I'd bet that he's going in the top 15 picks of the NFL draft. I mean, look who we just drafted. Trey Lance has 300 attempts in college. He played one game last year.
Five QBs in the top 15.
Yeah, Mac Jones just got drafted.
Kyle Trask went in the second round. You tell me, yeah. Matt Corral's not guaranteed second round.
Right. Yeah. I mean, you know, Matt, worst case scenario, Corral's going 35th.
Right.
Right. With the third pick in the second round, I don't think that's happening. There's just too much going on. You can see it daily within the NFL. But do I think he'll go top 15, top 20, has a chance to go top five? Absolutely. I mean, Trey Lance just went in the top five. Trey Lance from North Dakota State. And he had 300 attempts in college. You know, Matt Corral will have 300 attempts in September. Okay, so what are we doing? I mean, this is, I don't even know about Justin Fields. I mean, it's he's a big name, and just because he played at Ohio State, let me ask you this. How many awesome Ohio State quarterbacks have we had the last 30 years in the NFL? Five, four, three, two,
yikes,
one. Exactly. So, I mean, y'all told me Zeke was, you know, a game changer. He's not. So, anyway, if I had to bet a grand at the Golden Moon Casino, I would bet that he's a top, you know, 15 pick. If I said 15 round, that's not right. Top 15 pick in the first round of the NFL draft. We all know that there's not 15 rounds in the NFL draft. Live in the Bank Plus studio. Show is also brought to you by Dancing Rabbit Golf. DancingRabbitGolf.com to book a tee time. Buddy's trip. I was going back and forth with Bartu. It looks like he will come in this fall for a game.
Let's go.
We're trying to, you know, he gets all high maintenance about elk season. Okay.
That's a fact.
And so, like they're not going to be there. Right. And so I told him, I said, well, that buddy, that's 4 weeks of hunting. You know, you're already out there scouting. For whatever that's just a, by the way, we all know this. That's just an excuse to leave the house for a night or two. I mean, that's what hunting camps are. I get it. But the point is,
the difference is,
honey, I have to go plant sunflowers. And four other guys are meeting me up there with four bottles of bourbon and 15 steaks. And I mean, this is serious stuff.
The difference is Bartu's like actually in the woods, like eating berries and
he is
like that. I would agree with you that he was just getting out of the house, except
doesn't have a lap. But first of all, he is one of the tightest people I know.
He is so tight.
He would never, if I took him through the Delta, the Lexington area, Holmes County.
Yeah.
Whatever. Outside of Greenwood, Clarksdale, Drew. Whatever. If I took him to see some of the hunting camps that I've been in, or lodges that I've been in, you've been in, people listening either have or have been in.
Yes.
It'd be mind-boggling. He's to him. He'd be like, what?
He's so pragmatic. He'd be like, why do you need all this?
Because he sleeps in a sleeping bag.
Exactly.
You know, because he's got all these stories about how close coyotes and bears have gotten to him over the years.
He slept in his car at the world's largest outdoor cocktail party. You think he's afraid to sleep under some pine needles?
I stayed at the nicest hotel downtown.
And he slept
in his car. That was only because that was the only place I could find a room. I think I paid $280 a night when I went to the cocktail party.
It's cheaper than the College World Series.
Hey, I got some Hilton points. Or whatever. I was at the Hyatt. I don't remember. The point is, he stayed, and I got two queen beds.
Yeah.
In the room.
You planned accordingly. You had accommodations.
It was a very nice hotel.
Yeah. Y'all weren't snuggling up together.
Right. Maybe somebody affiliated with the game helped me get the rooms. But whatever. The point is, and the VIP passes. The point is that Bartu slept in his rental car in the parking garage of the whatever hotel I stayed at.
The Gus bus is broke.
Yes. And I was like, now he would come up and shower in the hotel room that I had.
Thank goodness.
But, you know, I was like,
that's just who he is.
It's who he is.
He's the guy.
He drove back on Saturday night. All right, so he did not drink on Saturday. Okay. And then the game bled into, I'm Eastern time, right? It's a 3:30 kick, 6:30 it's over.
Yeah.
We go to some cool Morton's.
Yeah.
Which is in the hotel.
It's a great place.
And I buy the little maniac a filet, because he would never, ever buy a filet at Morton's. Ever. He's never done that in his whole life. That's how tight he is. I mean, it was either he was going to get a cheese, which there's nothing wrong. He was going to get a cheeseburger at Rally's or something. Then we hang out for a little while. We watch Mississippi State beat A&M at the bar at Morton's while we're eating. He drives to Orlando, where he's flying out the next morning.
Incredible.
And he sleeps in the airport parking garage.
Electric.
Yeah. That's Dave Bartu for you. He's a little bit of Rambo. You know, a little bit of Davy Crockett, I guess. Yeah. I mean, he fit right in at Mossy Oak. He would fit right in with Toxie in the crew at Mossy Oak. Out of Bounds, Big Board, coming up next.
Swoochie Boochie, good morning to you.
The Out of Bounds Show podcast is brought to you by Boar's Head. Premium meats, cheeses, and hummus. Boar's Head. Compromise elsewhere.
What's on the Big Board?
All right, we'll have some, we have it actually, but we're going to play it on at 7:30. Really good Lane Kiffin audio from yesterday. Sound bites today, brought to you by the New York Style Pizza at Sal and Mookie's. New location in the district in Eastover, and of course, Sal and Mookie's in Madison. New York Style Pizza. Sal and Mookie's. Jackson, Sal and Mookie's, Madison. Good morning. Welcome in. Out of Bounds, 105.9 The Zone. Hello, Kay Adams. She looks like she's ready for training camp. So if she's ready, then Blake and I are ready.
Cowboys report tomorrow, officially.
Cowboys report tomorrow. They flew out yesterday, right?
Yeah, I don't know how many. Yeah, sure. I know David Hellman and crew flew out yesterday. I'm sure the rest are...
Okay, maybe the team went yesterday or today.
Who knows?
Gotcha. So Dak Prescott and the Dallas Cowboys get ready early because they will be a part of the Hall of Fame game in Canton, Ohio.
Against
who?
The
Cleveland Browns.
No.
Cincinnati Bengals. Pittsburgh Steelers.
There you go. I was like, you're in the right division, wrong.
The Pittsburgh Steelers.
The Fighting Ben Roethlisbergers.
Ooh. Or would you go Rocky Blyer, okay. Lynn Swann, Terry Bradshaw, Mean Joe Green, or Bill Cowher?
I don't know. At this point, Tomlin's, I mean, what's he now, like 12 years?
Oh, man, he's been there a long
13
time.
13 years,
He's done a really good job.
Won one and lost one now at this point? Or,
is that right?
Yeah, so okay. I think he...
Golly, can you imagine if he gets one more?
Yeah.
That's serious.
It's incredible. Ben Roethlisberger fighting to stay upright this season, stay healthy.
Tomlin is a good coach. He's also fortunate he's had a Hall of Fame QB the whole run.
And structure.
Oh.
Well-run organization.
No, the Rooneys, great Pittsburgh GM. Steelers. Yeah.
Yeah.
Is it Kevin Gilbert?
I believe that's
Kevin,
correct.
Well, yeah. So they are run really, 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 really well. So we got Cowboys and the Steelers.
That'll be the first taste of NFL
preseason. That was
NFL
the game in the 70s.
Yeah.
Okay. Chuck Knoll.
Oh, yeah.
Tom Landry. Roger Staubach. Terry Bradshaw.
You get the terrible towels going.
Yeah.
Yes, yeah. Sir.
Dee Lewis from Mississippi State.
Hey.
Yeah.
It always comes back to Mississippi, doesn't it?
It does. It does. Franco Harris.
He wasn't any good, was he?
Lambert. And then on the other side with the Cowboys, you know, you had Roger Staubach and Drew Pearson, who's going into the Hall of Fame.
That's correct. Finally.
Yeah.
Finally. His throw was magnificent.
Yes. Man, Drew, if he played in...
Modern football.
Oh,
yeah.
Man.
Yeah. One of a multitude.
Lynn Swann.
Would have torn it up.
But I tell you who, if Ahmad Rashad, he was my favorite player growing up. I don't know why. I love the Minnesota Vikings uniforms. But
Purple People Eaters.
Yeah. Bud Grant could never win it.
Dude.
He went to 4 Super Bowls, kind of like Marv Levy. But... Couldn't break through, so to speak. See, Fran Tarkenton was a quarterback during some of that time. He's from Georgia, or went to Georgia. And had Ahmad Rashad played in modern time with all these Mahomes, Russell Wilson, yeah. Aaron Rodgers, Dak, all these guys.
Just the incredible offenses.
Yeah. There is no telling what Ahmad Rashad, Lynn Swann, Drew Pearson, among others, would... Oh, and look. I read the article over the weekend, theathletic.com, on Kellen Winslow Sr.
Yeah.
And how he revolutionized. And he was my favorite player, too. I remember that Dolphins game as a kid. I actually got that. It was a game of the week, believe it or not. And when they had to help Winslow Sr. off the field after catching like 13 passes for 180 yards. And what, guess who the offensive coordinator was for Air Coryell? Joe Gibbs, who would end up in with the Redskins.
That's
right?
Correct.
And so he and that staff figured out a way to not just ask Kevin Winslow Sr. to do what all the other coaching staffs were doing, which is put your hand in the ground and block as a tight end,
like,
which is
freak.
One, boring, and two, ridiculous, right?
Yeah.
And so they were really either the first or one of the first to start to move him around and allow him to be, wait for it, a hybrid.
Yeah. They were like, they're going to put a...
or a flex.
They're going to put a 240-pound linebacker on you that runs a 5-4.
Nobody can cover him, Blake.
Yeah, well,
nobody.
That's because there weren't safeties in the game built the way
right.
we build safeties.
No doubt.
No Tyrann Mathews.
Like, linebackers today are asked to cover some people, whether they do it well or not.
Yes.
Back then, nobody was asked.
Correct.
I mean, an outside linebacker was asked to stop the run, contain a certain part of the field. Blah,
yep.
blah, blah, blah.
Yep. Right? It's like you have this 10-yard square grass.
Right.
Don't let anyone through it.
I mean, again, you know? Football for the most part was boring.
Yeah.
And you know, it was Franco Harris.
And all of a sudden you right? got Kellen Winslow up the seam for 15 yards and the linebacker's not 8 yards near him.
and I don't remember exactly enough about the Chargers other than I loved Fouts and I loved Winslow Sr.
They just did it differently.
But I don't know why they didn't have quite enough to get there. You know, San Diego, now L.A., has always been built a little soft, so they probably just didn't have enough teeth.
A little?
On the defense. I don't think they really believed in tackling out west.
A lot soft.
And in the trenches. Now, the one thing that Bill Walsh was capable of doing during that time was build a toughness component out west that you had with Pittsburgh and you had with, obviously, the New York Giants and the Washington
Redskins. The 49ers were built East Coast.
Yeah.
It was different.
Even though they were flashy, Walsh had a toughness component within that organization and the line of scrimmage. I mean, Ronnie Lott would absolutely decapitate you.
It was a lot like Ohio State. They were a SEC team in the Big Ten. You know what I mean? Like, it was kind of like the 49ers were a East Coast team on the West Coast.
Yes, yes. I mean, obviously, Kansas City had some toughness over the years. And Denver, again, you know, Pat Bowlen, one of the better owners in the history of the league.
But I don't think Denver West Coast.
As far as out west.
Yeah, exactly.
You didn't really get that. Now, there weren't that many, you know, teams. Nobody was worried about the Seahawks.
Yeah.
But
the Cardinals were not really.
The Chargers were. I mean, they were just incredible.
It's interesting the way you talk about that because
and they had
me,
a lightning bolt on their helmet.
Well, for me, it was the Rams, the
and
greatest
then
show on turf.
Senior was great. Oh, speaking of Cam Akers tore his Achilles. Yeah. We got to get into that too.
Yeah.
That was devastating. Go
but
ahead.
For me, growing up, it was the same thing. It was the way Kurt Warner and the like, Torrey Holt, Isaac Bruce, the stuff they did offensively.
You haven't said my favorite player on that team. You can think of it. He's from New Orleans and went to San Diego State or whatever, San Diego. He's a running back.
I know.
Marshall
Faulk. There you go. Only what, a top, you know, five running back probably
He's
of all time.
He's incredible.
So their offense was so unique, especially as a kid from Mississippi.
Oh, look.
When I watched them, I cheered hard for the Rams with no affiliation other than they were cool.
Wasn't it the greatest show on turf?
That's what I said. Yeah, because they played in St. Louis.
Yeah.
And they had terrible but
incredible.
Interesting
that,
uniforms.
I mean, that is a baseball town, and they were in St. Louis, and they won the Super Bowl and had a chance to win another one.
Yes.
That's incredible.
I cheered hard for them
in
the Super Bowl.
They're not really a football town.
Well, they're no longer,
I mean, the
a football
St. Louis
town
Cardinals
at all.
Are kind of like the Pittsburgh Steelers.
Yeah.
They've been run well for decades.
And the Rams obviously don't exist there anymore. So,
right.
So you don't even have the football. But, yeah, it is interesting. We look at what Ole Miss and State are doing by hiring offensive guys. And you go, that's what attracts the next generation. You have to have something innovative and explosive on offense to keep people interested.
Oh, why do you think Southern Miss hired Will Hall? I mean, Will Hall's going to move the ball. You know, I mean, he's going to score touchdowns. That's fun. People get excited, right? That's why Greg Byrne hired Dan Mullen. I mean, Ole Miss had some success on the offensive side of the football. Greg looked at this and said, this is the biggest nonsense I've ever seen in my life. Never seen a program make it so difficult to score points. The Out of Bounds Show is powered by MississippiSportsMedicine.com. and their new surgery center and clinic, Lakeland Drive, Flowood, Mississippi Sports Medicine and Orthopedic Center. Visit MississippiSportsMedicine.com. Kiffin Audio, next.
The Out of Bounds Show podcast is powered by Breezy Oaks Ranch for Mississippi-raised premium Wagyu beef and heritage pork shipped straight to your door. Visit BreezyOaksRanch.com.
Check it out.
This is the SEC Insider Hit. It's driven by the John Deere tractors at Mississippi Ag. Visit AgUp.com to find a retail location near you.
Let's go.
All right. Good morning. Welcome in. Your SEC Insider Hit is brought to you by Mississippi Ag. To manage your land, that's where you go, Mississippi Ag, and get your next John Deere tractor. Mississippi Ag, two locations, Canton and Pearl. AgUp.com to find the 16 locations spread out around the state. And the closest retail location to you, Mississippi Ag, AgUp.com. For your next John Deere tractor or John Deere lawnmower, Ag Up, Mississippi Ag. Good morning. Welcome in. The Mississippi Ag text line is 601-885-3776. We're going to move BreezyOaksRanch.com. You know, they'll ship steaks and pork chops and sausage right to your door out of Baden and Canton, Mississippi. BreezyOaksRanch.com crew will be in next week. Hey. When you're running two different farms, things happen. And so they shot us a text at like 4:55 this morning and let us know that they had to make sure other things were happening, and they will join us next week. Now, tomorrow we're going to do the Doc Rockers in studio. And Blake texted me yesterday. So this is what happened. The Out of Bounds Show, 105.9 The Zone, ESPN. I've been spending a lot of time out and about because I guess I was gone for 6 weeks or something. I don't know what happened. But anyway, the Blakey Blakester texted me yesterday, and he's doing some R&D.
Science.
It's all about the science, according to some, right? So we've got this research and development thing going on with the Out of Bounds Show.
New wing of the department.
Yeah. We've been doing this for years. What exactly we're doing, we don't know, but we've been able to pull off.
We're doing it.
I don't know how many food segments and drink segments over the years. Now, there's not a lot of, you know, blueprint planning, but we do it. It's fun. And y'all have consumed it.
Tucker asked me yesterday, he goes, so y'all just like talk on the phone in the afternoon and figure out what you're doing for the next day? I was like, yeah, basically.
Yeah.
I was like, that's it.
Yeah, I mean,
oh, it works.
This isn't rocket science.
It's way less glamorous behind the curtain.
Ryan says, where can I apply? All right, so here's the deal. Which, Ryan, you know, come on in. Blake's, or somebody, we don't even know. Somebody is going to, it's not going to be me.
Yeah, it's all right? You'll be drinking.
People figure this out for me. But the point is, we are going to do Doc Rockers in the third hour.
Correct.
Of the show tomorrow. Well, Blake texted me yesterday after we had been on the phone, and I've been in Rankin County a lot the last couple of weeks, and we've got some exciting stuff coming to you from there that we're really, really fired up about. And he says, now I see what y'all are talking about, because Blake was too young to ever experience the dock.
Yeah, it closed when I was in sixth grade.
Okay, so there you go. Unless Ed was taking you for a cheeseburger on a Saturday.
Oh, I did confirm Ed had been there many a time. Probably more the Sunday crowd. But
I see Ed as more of a Saturday during the day or Sunday during the day guy.
Correct.
Get some fried mushrooms.
Yes.
Get a delicious cheeseburger.
100%.
And just kind of let the breeze coming off the reservoir hang out.
Absolutely.
No
doubt. That's look, Ed for sure.
I had a large time from, you know, 17 to 22.
I would have too.
But I was kind of over it. But I still had friends who were mad at it.
Yes.
23, 25, 27, 30.
Took it serious.
Yeah. I mean, if it was open, they were there.
Yeah. All right? And when it closed, they were still
there.
That's
right. And I just call me you know, Grant, call me whatever. I'm good. I'm still like that.
You're a middle reliever. You'll come in for an inning or two, and then you're headed back to the bullpen.
And I'm not a marathon anywhere. I mean, you know, my dad had a comment. My dad's from the Delta, and they know how to entertain, and obviously they had some parties in the 50s and so on. But he had a great quote 30-something years ago. I'll never forget this. Maybe I'd come in or something, or they had some people over. And he said, son, some people don't have going home sense. And I never forget that.
Yeah.
And it's those people that stay and stay and stay and stay. And I'm like, I mean, we've all said enough.
Sometimes it's time to go home.
Yeah. But anyway, back to where I'm going with the doc. I mean, the doc rocker.
I texted you after doing some R&D.
Yeah, and you went, no wonder y'all talk about this drink.
I would have spent many a salary.
Because I'm not into frozen drinks. Most of them are made way too sweet with artificial garbage and so on. Well, this you know, they whatever DeWitt DeWeese and this group did, they nailed it.
Yeah, I'd like to call it a pina colada on steroids.
Okay.
Because it's got a pina colada base, and then they've souped it up.
Right, right. And we're going to make them tomorrow morning, and they'll be on the webcast, which you can watch the show on Facebook, search the Out of Bounds Show, or YouTube, Out of Bounds Sports. All right, so we're going to do that. Now, I got to get into one thing. Give me 5 minutes before I get in, and then the next 14 minutes or so will be Lane Kiffin. I grew up with Magic Johnson, Larry Bird, Isaiah Thomas, and Michael Jordan. And Alex English and Adrian Dantley and Charles Barkley was my favorite player. And I loved hoops, and I got to go to NBA games and the Final Four and other stuff as a kid, and I was very blessed to do that. And so I love hoops, even though this is a football, baseball show now. Okay? I mean, who knows where it'll go. But Giannis and the Milwaukee Bucks beat Chris Paul and the Phoenix Suns last night. And so I watched several of the games, okay? And, you know, I think about some of the guys from back in the 80s, like Barkley, who, hey, you could argue is the most underrated player to ever play, right? I mean, the Dream Team book talks about how he was arguably the best player. The 84 Olympics, they'll tell you he was the best player. It's just Bobby Knight was, you know, an absolute and total Jack Blake, right? And so Barkley's got a little bit of old school and a little bit of new school. And when you look at the way that Giannis plays, and he is such an amazing athlete and player and person, by the way. I mean, what an amazing young man. It's just so, I mean, I already knew Chris Paul was awesome. And a super dude, but he's like, what is he, like 11 years older than Giannis or something like that. But when you look at the way Giannis plays, there's some throwback and then there's some new, right? He's got a little LeBron in him. He's got a little Barkley in him. I'd say he's got a little Kevin Garnett in him. You know, he's not the Steph Curry, Damian Lillard, shooter. Durant's obviously a great, great shooter among many in the league this day and age, where the game continues to be extended to 22 feet, 24 feet, and even in their sleep, 26 feet. And it's not going away, right? I mean, Rick Pitino ran the analytics 35 years ago, among others, and threes are better than twos. That's pretty simple, even in our crazy world today. But when you look at the way Giannis plays, and the fact that he really plays, Blake, between 12 and 15 feet of the basket. Now, he's so athletic that he can move. It's unbelievable he's that big. Same thing with LeBron. Same thing with Barkley and others. But it's unbelievable that he can move and glide the way he can. And then think about what he is on the defensive end, right? I mean, this guy is a great player, but he's not Steph. He's not Kobe, he's not Jordan, and he's not Durant, who are all, like, beautiful players, You know, I mean, they're guards. They can take the ball coast to coast. They can play 20, 25 feet away from the basket. And I understand that, you know, Jordan didn't get the, he wasn't known as a three-point shooter, so to speak. But as I watch Giannis in the Bucks, it's a little bit like Mississippi State's team making their run baseball-wise. I mean, Milwaukee is, you know, in middle America, in rural America. Giannis could have left. He decided to stay. Most of the stars are trying to go to super teams. There's really only so many super teams you can have. One every now and then, maybe two. You know, LeBron kind of bottled it in Miami, although D-Wade and was already getting old. And Bosh was never the player that they made him out to be. Good player, not great. And then you look at what Golden State was able to do with Klay and Steph and KD. And LeBron tried to do some things in L.A., but Anthony Davis is not Giannis. How about that? If y'all tried to tell me Anthony Davis is a star for years. He's not. A guy who can take over the game is Giannis. Like, Kevin Durant couldn't do what Giannis did. Even though Kevin Durant is a better, more deadly player, because Durant can extend his game to 24 and 25 feet and shoot from the bus in the parking lot, like Larry Bird could, right? Like Steph can, and like others. Giannis has that dog in him. And he decided to stay in a small market, and they pick up a couple of players who are really, really good, and they win it. It is an incredible story. And look, Phoenix is young and needs to get in the weight room and all that stuff outside of Chris Paul. And Devin Booker I like, and Ayton and so on. But they got to look. It was obvious that the team that had a little bit older player, again, outside of Chris Paul, who couldn't play like you would normally because he's 36 years old, it was a thing of beauty. So he's a little bit of Barkley. He's a little bit of LeBron. You could argue he's a little bit of Akeem. Akeem was a beautiful player. That's why he was so much better than Patrick Ewing. Ewing got all the pub because he was out of the Big East and the East Coast and a bigger media market than Akeem playing at the University of Houston in college. Akeem was by far and away better than Ewing, obviously. But and there's some others that I think you could throw out that he could remind you, you know, of. But got a little Kevin McHale in him too, so. But what a beautiful player. What a great championship for the Milwaukee Bucks. I'm sorry, Blake. Go ahead.
No, I was going to say, there's a reason you compare him to Akeem. The stats and the numbers that he put up for this finals are only matched by guys who played down low over the course of the NBA. So
right.
Shaq,
right.
Some of your better elite.
Oh, and he's got
centers.
Some Shaq in him too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because Giannis
Shaq's
plays.
Footwork is so off. As good as Ewing was, as good as, well, Ralph Sampson could never get there, although a great college player. Obviously, Wilt was brilliant.
Shaq's athleticism was a whole nother different animal.
The way that he could run the court and his footwork,
dude, when he
unheard
was
of at 7-1.
When he was with Orlando.
And same thing with Giannis.
When Shaq and Penny were in Orlando.
Yeah.
You want to talk about elite basketball?
Well, and then when Shaq gets hooked up with Kobe.
It totally changes. You know, and Shaq grew and his game changed as he got bigger
sure.
and whatever and older. But his athleticism to start his career, it was insane.
I heard Shaq's already a billionaire. Is that true?
It's probably accurate.
Okay.
The amount of stuff he does.
It's incredible. Well, so instead of getting paid, Shaq goes into a deal and gets a piece of the deal.
Most of the time.
And there's a different deal. Barkley mentioned this years ago. He said Jordan called him when Gatorade and Nike, they were already with Jordan. And Jordan said, don't take the money, take the stock. But
because it exponentially
absolutely.
Grows. Yeah.
And but anyway, evidently Shaq is approaching billionaire status. Because,
that wouldn't surprise me.
And see,
me
that's
at
what
all.
Peyton Manning's doing.
Well, Shaq does all the TV stuff. He's
Peyton
so
is
diversified.
Taking a, he's creating his own. So he has Omaha.
Omaha Productions.
All right, so we all know that Peyton Manning. We'll switch gears here for one more second before we go to Kiffin. Peyton Manning, we all know, Omaha with the He started that with the Broncos, right? I don't think. Did he do it with the Colts?
No. Yeah, he did Omaha and Indianapolis. Right.
I thought it was started with
the
Broncos.
No, it's been his thing forever, yeah.
So he's got Omaha Productions, and what Peyton has decided, instead of, and look, Romo's deal isn't bad, right? 18 to 20 million a year for 10 years or whatever it is. But instead of doing that, everything that he's doing with ESPN or NBC or ESPN/Disney is he owns the deal or they own it together instead of them paying him a talent fee, Blake, if you will.
He's getting residual income.
Right. And so, like some of these other media, like, you know, Portnoy and Ben, what's the guy, the ringer?
Simmons.
Yeah. Instead of doing that, what Peyton has decided to do is create his own media company and bring people in.
Yep.
Right? So now he's got Big Poppy working under the Omaha Productions brand, but he's going to do kind of like what Peyton did this past, what, couple of years?
Yeah.
As far as Peyton's places. So he's bringing in Big Poppy. He may bring in somebody else. And he's giving Big Poppy a chunk, but it's all under the Omaha Productions deal.
Now he's got a college trivia show on NBC under Omaha Productions. So that's a partner. You know, that's one of their products.
He went in and he owns some of that deal.
He sold some to NBC and then he owns it and they do it on NBC's channel and it's a hit.
But
you know?
They use all of their manpower and resources to do it.
Yep.
He's Peyton Manning and Omaha gets 30, 40, 50, whatever percent of it. So that's where Peyton is doing he's already built.
It's the next wave of athletes.
Absolutely.
Though. You see LeBron do it. You see all these new guys do it.
I think Peyton realizes even at wherever he is, $400 or $500 million, if he ever wants to own a team or something much bigger, you know, he is going to have to get into billionaire status, like way in that. Now I know he can bring in some investors, but it is absolutely brilliant from Peyton Manning and his team of advisors. And this is what Shaq has done. Hey, I'll do a deal. No. Don't pay me $12 million.
Yeah.
I want a chunk of the deal. I want to own the rights. I want to generate content through my company.
Shaq probably could still be living off of what he made in the NBA. You know what I mean? Like he could have put that aside and be living off his NBA salary still, and everything he's making in terms of stocks, he doesn't even need. You know what I mean? Like he's just building. For the future. So it's one of those unique circumstances. Peyton would be in the same spot with what he made. It's not like he needs more money. So now it's about accruing real wealth.
That's right. All right. Now let's switch gears to Lane Kiffin. Out of Bounds, 105.9 The Zone, ESPN. Brought to you by the Men's Clinic in Madison. If you feel like you're low testosterone and you need more energy and sex drive and among many other things, you can go get a free blood test at the Men's Clinic in Madison on Highland Colony. Dr. Mike Manning and Dr. Cliff Adams will then walk you through what you need. TheManThing.com, the Men's Clinic. You can call and schedule and get a free blood test at the Men's Clinic in Madison. TheManThing.com, TheManThing.com, Dr. Mike Manning and Dr. Cliff Adams. We're live in the Bank Plus studio. The Farm Bureau Insurance call-in line is 601-707-3750. Squirrel is calling the text line right now. We appreciate that, Squirrel. And we were debating a couple of pieces of audio from Lane. Which one are we going with first?
I've got two. I've got one on NIL and one on Bryce. Well, they're both on NIL, but one's Bryce Young.
No, I like the Bryce Young.
All right.
Lane train yesterday. We'll get into Deion Sanders, too. I got it. I got the text. We'll get into Deion throwing a fit, another one. Weird deal. This is Lane Kiffin talking name, image, likeness, and the fact that there's talk that Bryce Young is doing about $1 million worth of endorsement deals.
I'm still blown away on this Bryce Young. Like, you guys made $1 million already? That's good, man. He don't need to play next year against us. And I mean...
just sit out. You're good.
Oh, man. All right. And this is also the Lane train yesterday. in Hoover, SEC Media Days, talking name, image, likeness.
In these conversations with recruits, how relevant is the conversation about NIL opportunities at Ole Miss?
Well, it is. You know, it's a part of recruiting now. And so we're in the beginning of that. And I think we're going to learn a lot over a year. You know, what happens at all the different places and the compliance aspect of it. And I mean, just if you guys that were in there, you know, learning the press conference that Coach Saban said Bryce has made $1 million already. You know, it's wild. You know, it's we're professional sports.
Yes. And have
because we really have free agency too now.
Yes. Yes. You have been professional sports. Everybody has been paid. The coaches, the athletic directors, the, you know, the vendors, the sports management, sports marketing companies, and so on. And so now Bryce Young, who really has never done anything, as quarterback of the Alabama Crimson Tide, evidently has maybe seven figures worth of deals on the table.
That's incredible. And Nick, that's from Saban mentioned that in his press conference at Media Days.
That's correct.
There are people saying, oh, it's not that much. But at the end of the day, this is so smart by Nick Saban. What's the conversation now? Alabama QB is making seven figures.
No question. Never let's played say a game. Let's say it's 210 grand.
Doesn't matter.
Exactly.
We're having the conversation.
Saban did that on purpose.
It's genius.
Yeah.
And the odds are if Bryce Young plays 2 years, he probably will make close to $1 million because there's so lucrative opportunity as the head guy of the head program in the biggest sport in college athletics.
Yeah.
You know, it is what it is.
Now, so the Lane train talked about, you know, Corral and Ely, and we're expecting some big, big things from Ely. He made the comment that, hey, now we realize what he can really do. We're really going to get him the football. Although he had a good year last year. Now, granted, last year Blake was weird, obviously. I mean, you didn't have the non-conference games. Ole Miss only played 9 games.
That's true.
You know, we forget that Ole Miss had a game canceled against Texas A&M.
Yeah. A&M didn't want that smoke.
At A&M, you know? And so we just didn't have the reps and the games that we're used to having. This year, we're hoping that all the teams play 12 games, and then we move on into the postseason. So we'll see. Lane said that he dropped 30 pounds, Blake, and is not going to start eating again until they play better defense.
So Lane Kiffin's going to starve to death?
It'll be interesting to see what DJ Dirk – they will be better. The question is, how much better will they be?
And is it enough to matter?
Yeah. And does it matter really this day? I mean, they were already good last – they were good last year and terrible on defense. Yeah. So if they'll trip over being 20 spots better, and it's all about, you know, we've been saying this for years, situational defense. I mean, between the 20s, whatever. What are you doing in the red zone? Can you create some turnovers? You know, things like that. Now, guess who's going to the podium today? The Pirate, Mike Leach. We'll see how that goes. Yeah, we'll see how that goes with the snarky media. We'll see. Out of Bounds, brought to you by Farm Bureau Insurance. Bundle your auto and home and save with your local Farm Bureau Insurance agent. Hour number 2 coming up. Good morning. Welcome in.